Good evening. This is Keith Johnson of New England Anomalies Research, NEAR. We're here at Slater Mill this evening with my co-host Sandra Johnson and co-founder of NEAR.
Good evening from Slater Mill.
Now this evening, we're participating in a ghost tour, which is held at Slater Mill, organized by my brother Carl Johnson. He's been doing them for several years now. They're a hit every season. Every year people come, and you've been on some ghost tours, right, Sandra?
I have been on many Slater ghost tours. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of luck capturing evidence here. Hopefully we'll get something tonight.
Yes, there's been a couple of EVPs you've gotten while you're here.
Absolutely. On one of the tours, I was able to capture an EVP that said 1792 in response to a question I had about how long have you been here? So that was pretty interesting. In fact, even more interesting in that the building has been here, or one of the buildings was built in 1792, as I recall.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And here we are in Slater Mill proper. This is the main building, Slater Mill. And of course, it was opened in 1793, constructed between 1792 and 1793. And we owe a great deal of gratitude to Samuel Slater here in Pawtucket, Rhode Island. He came from England. And this is the birthplace of the American Industrial Revolution right here at Slater Mill. And thanks to Moses Brown, who provided the capital for Samuel Slater to start his mill here. And here we are today investigating the paranormal aspects of it.
Well, I think we should get to it.
All right.
Are you ready?
I am ready. Ready
cool.
And willing.
Absolutely.
Of course, the Blackstone River, the rushing waters of the Blackstone River right next to this mill, and that's of course what powered these buildings when they were working mills, the current from the Blackstone River. Now of course that's running water, which provides somewhat of a current. Also, there is a very, very high mineral content within the waters of the Blackstone River as it rushes by, and also in the stone building, the Wilkinson Mill. Now, there's properties within stone, and Richard Felix from England, the UK, he has spoken about this. He believes that certain kind of rocks inside buildings can actually act as recording devices, which would explain why so many residual haunts are experienced in England, in the UK, and a lot of those old centuries old buildings there. Now, of course, our country is much newer, much younger, but we have these mills, and this is extremely important to American history, the birthplace of the American Industrial Revolution. So of course, many, many things happened here along the years, and we feel that some of it might have been embedded or recorded somehow within these stones, sometimes referred to as the Pizer effect, which is why a crystal watch will retain memory. See, it's the same theory. Now, of course, when these mills started, especially this one, Slater Mill itself, much of the labor force was child labor. You could be as young as 6 years old and begin working here at Slater Mill. In fact, when this mill opened up, the foreman who worked right under Samuel Slater was 10 years old. He was 10 years old, but you have to realize much of the workforce was younger than him. And he was actually Samuel Slater's youngest brother-in-law, Smith Wilkinson. And of course, the stone building is named after the Wilkinson family.
Yes, you can activate your glow sticks anytime you'd like. Blackstone River has a long and rich history, and some of that history is punctuated with elements of tragedy. One such tragedy was the Mackinac. It was August 18, 1925, and the pleasure boat Mackinac was making its way out of Newport Harbor after a day's outing at the J.P. Coates Company. 15 minutes after the ship left the harbor, headed toward the Pawtucket River past the dam in Falls here, a boiler aboard the ship exploded due to a weakened wall. Within seconds, the Mackinac and his passengers were engulfed in a cloud of vapor. Some jumped overboard and were later rescued. Many were not so fortunate. This resulted in the loss of 55 lives. Now, there was the case of poor Albert A. Jackson. We do not know why, on the winter solstice, December 21st, 1907, Albert A. Jackson decided to make his way across the Blackstone River, precariously close to Pawtucket Falls. I don't know, maybe Albert was celebrating the holidays early that year. But Albert walked through the water to get to the other side of the river. The next morning, the lifeless body of Albert Jackson was found with a leg wedged under a rock bobbing in the Blackstone River. And a block and tackle had to be lowered from Main Street Bridge to retrieve his body. Now, there was a quaint business based at Slater Mill in the 1870s. It was called coffin trimmings. At Slater Mill, they manufactured the satin bushings for linings for coffins for all over the country. And we wonder why it's haunted. One storm that came raging through the Blackstone Valley occurred in August 1955. We were hit by Hurricane Diane. This happened 2 weeks after Hurricane Connie. Hurricane Diane flooded Precious Blood Cemetery in Woonsocket so severely that the western earthen embankment was washed away, exposing coffins. If you visit Precious Blood Cemetery, you can see how that can and probably will happen again. Now, some of those coffins slid down the embankment in Precious Blood Cemetery, went into the Blackstone River, were washed away with the current. Some were retrieved, but some went all the way out into Narragansett Bay in the Atlantic Ocean. To this very day, there are bodies reburied in Precious Blood Cemetery. Nobody knows if they're in the proper graves. There's nothing anybody can do about it.
For a time, Samuel Slater was the wealthiest man in America. And 2 years before Mr. Slater died, in the year 1835, President of the United States, Andrew Jackson, came to see Samuel Slater at Slater's home in Webster, Massachusetts. And President Jackson calls Samuel Slater the father of American manufacturers. And that's how we've known him ever since, as the father of American manufacturers. We're going to try and break through the veil between the two worlds, the world of the living and the world of the deceased, those who have passed on. So we're going to speak to the personality that remains here in Slater's Mill. Now, if you feel touched, or you feel a cold breeze travel by you that you can't explain, or you hear something that sounds extraneous, especially a voice, or something comes out in your photographs, please share that with us. It's something you didn't expect. We come here as your friends and your guests. This is your mill. You were here long before us. We don't mean to frighten you or be invasive. We only want to learn about you. If you could come into our circle, be with us, we might be able to feel you and touch you. Primarily, what I'm looking for is a cold spot. We've noticed that here in Slater Mill. There is a cold spot that travels around. It's about 3.5 feet off the ground where it starts. It used to move around more, but now it's more static. It stays put for longer periods. We're guessing that that's the spirit of a child because of its height. We really don't know what it is for sure. The great thing about this is you can feel what is probably a spirit. Starting right here. This is where I feel it. Right about here.
So that's about
66.3.
So it's slowly, slowly but steadily dropping.
It was clear when I feel like cold air right here.
Yeah, that's where I was feeling. All right, let me see. Almost following it now. It's like, whoop. More here.
I feel like it just passed by my leg. Like it's right over here.
And that's what people get. People feel, even in the daytime, say, woo. I hear people go that. And I say, anything happened? And they say, well, just something brushed by my leg.
Yeah.
They're afraid it's a rodent
or
something.
It's like when you're
usually up here.
Like when you feel like air conditioning, that's what I feel.
Yeah.
That's what I feel right now.
Yeah.
Right. That's a,
68. Yeah, it's right here.
Okay, is the
I didn't feel that
is the temperature
really.
Fluctuating more?
Yes, 65.
Right leg is
like, it's like bouncing, huh?
Yes, it is. Yeah, it's moving.
And for a split second, I had a from 0.1 to 0.5 and back to 0.1.
It's right
good.
Here.
You people over here have a temperature fluctuation?
Like, he has a temperature.
Do you feel that
right?
Yeah.
Am I going to
wind up?
Maybe
it's going down.
64.9 back
up. To get somebody. So.
That's amazing.
Well, wait, no,
62.7. I thought it went up.
Nothing high, like from 0.0.1 to 0.5 back to 0.1 real quick.
See, now it's going back up because I kept left.
Right here in this area.
Like right here.
In the middle, and I don't know what's under
62.
The floor.
Is there electrical wires here? Well, but I think if it was, it would be constant. It would be,
61.
It wouldn't do that.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Oh my God.
So my batteries on my recorder were good before I left the house. They were full bars and they'd warm them right up. I took them out and moved them around.
Really? Full drain then?
Full drain.
It's the darndest thing. Now, I can't think of anything normal.
That's interesting.
I never thought that. Because I said, I'm not going to bring back up because I'm not worried about that.
7
degrees.
7 degree difference.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are now going to enter the Wilkinson Mill, which was built in 1810, opened in 1811 as a machine shop and service station for Slater's Mill. As the operations in Slater's Mill became increasingly busy, the mill owners wanted to have their machine parts, gearings, bobbins, various tools and replacement parts for the spinning machinery in Slater's Mill manufactured here on the site. And Wilkinson Mill, while it differs from Slater Mill in more than just the name, Wilkinson Mill is made of 3 foot thick rubble stone walls, built like a fortress, because the heavy machinery was and is kept upstairs. And when the great water wheel below would spin around at full velocity, this whole building would shake like an earth tremor. You could say if the mill was a living body, its beating heart inside would be the great water wheel, because that was its life, that was its source of power.
Some of you may notice there happens to be a pair of crutches here in the corner. Now, the significance of that was because, well, this floor was a man's workforce, and it was run by David Wilkinson, who was Samuel Slater's brother-in-law. Now, the floor was very, very greasy because animal fat was used for lubrication of these gears. If a gentleman, a worker here, was unfortunate enough to slip and severely injure his leg, well, lend him a crutch for the day. That way he can keep his job by hobbling around and completing his work. Also, some people have noticed these crutches spontaneously flying out by themselves when you least expect it.
We should be so lucky as to have that happen tonight, but it has happened, yes. We are here at your mill, your workplace. We don't know why you keep coming back here, or maybe never left. But we see a shadowy form moving through. As I said earlier, it tends to be all the way or nothing in here, but sometimes it's pretty spooky. Primarily last week, anomalies came out in the pictures, the photographs that were taken here.
Was there a story about a gentleman that was seen on the staircase over there, down the other end of the building?
A shadow person was, yes.
Yeah.
Shadow person was seen there, back there. In fact, because that door kept opening and closing on its own, they put a latch on it, because they were hearing that upstairs too during the day. Shadow people have thought, that's one theory, that they are interdimensional. They go in and out of, they flux in and out of our reality. And because time is different for them, that's why they seem to move rapidly. They are most often reported as moving around, darting around, moving fast. Sometimes they're very small, sometimes they're human size, like the one I saw, like adult male size, and other times they're tall. And sometimes they wear hats and cloaks, so we really don't understand what a shadow ghost, a shadow person is.
Samuel Slater married Wilkinson?
Indeed he did. He married Hannah Wilkinson, sister of David Wilkinson. In fact, the story is, when he became a boarder at the Wilkinson house, he was 21 years old, Hannah was 17. Samuel Slater knocked on the door. It was opened by Hannah Wilkinson, their eyes met. It was love at first sight. Now, I don't know if that's romantic embellishment, but they were married approximately a year later. Supposedly, they had to force themselves to wait to get married for the purpose of etiquette.
All right, I just saw something over here. See that pulley gear?
Yes.
It's there.
This one, I saw this one move earlier.
You saw it move?
I
just saw a light on it.
It flashed leaving, like, you know, like that. I just kept thinking it was my
imagination. Huh. But it was very isolated. It was like about like a half square foot. And you saw that in motion?
It was like, I figured it was my imagination that I just kind of saw like a little wobble.
I wonder though.
I mentioned it.
Because that's just where I saw a light when I mentioned it. It lit up. I don't think any headlights from Main Street Bridge would cause that. It was right on it. You're starting to feel like, when you say tingling, you mean like touched or like like that? It may recognize you from you being here before, and you're the one who saw the rocking chair, and you're the one who started to, you don't feel that uncomfortable sensation,
no.
Do you? Good. Keith?
Yes.
Kathy's feeling all touching.
On my left side.
Left side?
Your left
just
side.
On the shoulder and the neck.
Feeling on the left side of your shoulder and neck?
Mm-hmm. It's all tingling. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, like when your feet go to sleep, you know, that tingling.
Yes.
All the way.
Do you feel uncomfortable being here?
No. It's not like
sometimes you have, because it's been pressing. You know,
yeah.
But now you don't. You feel it, but not uncomfortable.
Here, but it's all in the back.
We came to this building in peace, and we leave in peace, taking nothing unnatural or unholy with us, only that which is positive, angelic, and of the light. Amen.
Amen.
All right, I know there will be enough space for all of us in here, because originally 22 people lived here. Four adults, the parents, and 18 children of all various ages. That's when the Jenks brothers, for whom this house was built, owned the house. The house is named for Sylvanus Brown, who was a Revolutionary War veteran. Sylvanus Brown would smuggle gunpowder from the British encampments and bring them up to the north. And he was one of the original architects of Slater's Mill.
This is the Sylvanus Brown House, built in 1758. Named after Sylvanus Brown, who was a business partner of Samuel Slater, did much of the carpentry in Slater Mill and the machines, the wooden parts. Also, when Samuel Slater first arrived in Rhode Island in January of 1790, this house is where he stayed for less than a week. So he was a guest of Sylvanus Brown. It was actually built for two brothers named Jenks, Nathaniel and Ebenezer Jenks, in 1758. And of course, the two families had to share the house. So at one time, there were 22 people living here, 18 children and four adults. I hope they all got along. But of course, this house was moved here in 1962 to make way for the highway expanse. It was originally over on Marin Street, pretty much near the apex over there in the city of Pawtucket. But because this house has seen so much living, so much birth, life, death, it is also known as Memory Cottage. Now, downstairs, one of the tourists in 2008 was walking along the garden path. She looked up at one of the gambreled windows and she saw a little girl looking at her, dressed in old clothing, perhaps early American clothing. This woman came up and asked my brother Carl, who was on tour at the time, "Do you hire children to work here as tourists?" And Carl said, "No, why do you ask?" She explained about the little girl she had just seen in the upstairs window, and it so upset this woman that her bottom lip was trembling. Of course, my brother went in and checked the whole house, but there was no little girl in there, not that he could see. So it's always been a question of who that little girl represents. There have been other sightings of a young child in here. I myself was opening up the Brown House one morning for school children who were about to arrive in an hour or so. I had my heavy work shoes on. I was recording as I walked up the stairs. When I played the recording back, I heard a distinct female voice saying, "Quiet." So naturally, I walked quiet from then on. However, about 109-year-olds were about to traipse through in about an hour from then, so it wasn't very quiet then. But here's our beloved Sylvanus Brown House, known as Memory Cottage.
And I was recounting the story of a tourist who saw a little girl looking out of one of the upstairs narrow windows down there, and the lady was looking in the garden. She looked up, the little girl was looking down in old-fashioned clothes. She looked down, looked back up, and that little girl was still peering down at her. As soon as I told them that, all seven of us in the room clearly heard the laughter of a child just coming out of the air, right,
really?
Right in this room, yeah. And it was recorded. It was as loud as anything.
Wow.
I've heard giggling since then, but I haven't heard a loud laughter.
That's moving.
What's moving now? Did you? Did you touch it?
Oh, that is moving.
Just like with people, the course of least resistance, a spirit will move whatever's lightest that they can.
That's
cool. Who just banged? Is that somebody upstairs?
Yeah.
Must be
somebody
upstairs.
I'm trying to see
it moving.
Yeah.
Might have been.
It's like somebody's pushing it right now.
Yeah, that's not.
Yeah, let me push it back and see if.
Yeah, because it's moving.
Did that move out?
No, we're
in a pattern.
It's like moving out.
Okay.
It's not just going through that.
It looked like it was just moving by momentum a bit.
Becca or someone, if you want to move this more, you can.
Keep pushing it.
See if it starts moving now.
Yeah, I just saw it out of the corner of my eye. I'm like, what the heck?
Yeah, it's hard to see without the light. You might even hear some
giggling. We keep hearing movement from behind the door.
Yeah, there's something in there. Let me see.
Yeah, I can hear that.
Wow. There's definitely something in there. I almost heard it sound like a ball.
They have mountains out on that
stairs.
Yeah. I'm going to go over here.
Okay, we're recording. Can have Savannah's Brown House.
Becca, how did you die?
A cheap 9-volt battery, I guess. I don't know.
I have my sister here tonight, Becca. Can you make a signal to her to mention that you were here?
Did you just kill my EMF meter? Trellis, if you hear anybody moving upstairs, coincide with that, you know? If no one's moving upstairs, then...
Yeah.
It's just so odd, because it sounds like it's that knob, the
yeah,
thumb latch.
Yeah, I didn't hear anybody walking while that was doing
it. Touch it, and it's not doing anything. But it sounds like it is.
Like someone's trying to get out?
Right.
This is the master bedroom of the Sylvanus Brown House. Now, when the Jenks brothers lived here, I don't know who had this room, but this was the bedroom, the master bedroom, when Sylvanus Brown lived here and shared this room with his wife, Ruth. Now, I don't know, but this is very likely the room where he breathed his last breath, here in this room. Very possible, since this was the master bedroom. There's a cutaway of the original ceiling up there. Shows what the original ceiling to this house looked like. Obviously, we don't go upstairs very often because of that. It's a weak spot there. But this is, of course, a rope bed. What you notice in this room that's different from many rooms in the house, of the seven fireplaces in this house, there's no fireplace here. Actually, this pitcher, if we fill this with water during the winter time, by morning it'll be rock solid, be frozen solid.
Yikes.
So it's very, very cold in here. Very, very cold because there's no bedroom. They had their ways of keeping warm, though. One was a bed warmer, of course.
Bed warmer.
Yeah.
How quaint.
Ye old bed warmer. Of course, they would put embers from the fireplace in here, brass lid on, and you'd scoot it around the bed, get it nice and toasty warm, then scoot it under the bed for the night. Of course, they had each other to keep warm, too. This always reminds me of the episode of Bewitched when the...
I was going to say the same thing.
Yes, when the spirit in the bed warmer follows her home and from Salem, Massachusetts.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, many sensitives who have been in here, those who are intuitive, have picked up on various names in here, such as the name Elizabeth. But you know, so many people have lived in this house over the years since 1758, right up until 1960, 2 years before it was moved. There's innumerable families, names that were here that are no longer with us. But of course, this being the master bedroom, there was a lot of life seen in here.
I'm sure there was.
I mean, you have a building that had so many people in and out of it over the years, working so hard, so long, so stressed out, just trying to get, you know, the workday done. And then to have the accidents that we've heard about, these undocumented cases of people being injured in here, having limbs torn off, the stories about, you know, fabric being stained with blood and being taken down to the river and washed out, dried out, and for the next day to continue weaving it.
We've had incidents of visitors coming here, finding themselves overwhelmed by the atmosphere. I think the very first tour that I was doing, helping out with, we had four women who had to leave Slater Mill because in the middle of the tour,
right.
they felt so emotionally overwhelmed.
Mm-hmm. I mean, who knows how that poor kid met his end? And as they say, these things weren't documented. You don't want to broadcast the fact you're losing help because they're going in amongst the machinery and losing an arm. And first aid back then couldn't have been too great.
Right.
I mean, someone could bleed out awful quick, especially a child. So, you know, think about blood, sweat, and tears, from so much hard work, so much energy put into this business, this building. I have no doubt that it's imprinted with, you know, the past, so there's just no doubt about it.